today is December 9th, 1996. The survivor is Robert Weiss, W-E-I-S-S. The interviewer is Carol Raspler, R-A-S-P-L-E-R. We're in Boynton Beach, Miami, Florida District, USA. Language, English, and this is roll number one.
Today is December 9th, 1996, Monday. My name is Carol Raspler, R-A-S-P-L-E-R. We are here in Boynton Beach, Florida, Palm Beach County, United States of America, interviewing survivor Robert Weiss, W-E-I-S-S. We will be speaking in English. Robert, thank you very much for your testimony today. Would you like to introduce the handsome young man sitting to your right and tell us something about him, and perhaps he would tell us something?
This is Mike, my younger son, and I'm very proud of him. He's here with me in Florida, and perhaps he wants to say a few words.
Yes, it's made me very proud that my father has had this opportunity to share with you his experiences during the war. My brother and mother and I have, along with the rest of our family, have supported him through the last 8 or 9 years worth of his research and compiling all the information that he was able to share with you.
And have you learned a great deal?
Yes,
from all this?
I've learned a great deal from the information that my father has, and we'll be able to give that information on to other people, as well as learn from the experiences in my current life.
Thanks, Mike. Thank you very much. Robert, would you say your full name for us, please?
My name is Robert Richard Weiss.
And how do you spell that?
W-E-I-S-S.
Okay. And when were you born?
I was born March 16, 1923 in Vienna, Austria.
And that makes you how old today?
I'm 72 and a half.
72 and a half. Can you tell us a little bit of your parents and your family in Vienna?
My parents was Richard and Josephine Weiss. We had a very large family in Vienna. For example, my father had 9 brothers and sisters, and my mother 8. And we had countless cousins. And we were a very close family, which means we met frequently. On all Jewish holidays we met, and we joined together. My father was an college grad, was an officer in the Imperial Austrian Army in the First World War. He loved music, the arts. He had a large library at home. And I looked always up to him for his guidance. And he was, for example, a philatelist. And I'm still today a philatelist because I learned that from him. He was the owner of an textile mail order business in Vienna, which he ran with my mother. And it was also under the name of Richard and Josephine Weiss. It was located in the 9th district. The 9th district had also a temple in the, I believe it was the Müllnergasse. Unfortunately, this temple doesn't exist anymore. It was destroyed during the Crystal Night fires, where all the temples of Vienna were burned and destroyed. Only one survived, which exists still today. The reason of the survival of this particular temple is because it was in the house of the Jewish community, and the Nazis wanted to preserve this particular building because all the archives and all the activities were done there. So that's the reason actually this temple survived and exists today. I had a very happy childhood, and my childhood ended on March 13, 1938, 3 days before my 15th birthday. That was the entry of the Germans and the occupation of Austria. Hitler came to Austria, and of course our life changed.
Did you have any siblings, Robert?
Yes, I have an older brother by the name of Victor. He's 2 years older than me. He went in Vienna to the gymnasium, and he was fortunate to finish it.
You were saying that, I didn't mean to interrupt you, you were saying about the entry of Hitler into Austria and how your childhood ended abruptly.
My childhood ended because on this particular day we saw the Viennese population out in the streets greeting German troops and German officials in a manner we never thought possible before. And that was also the first time I heard shouting anti-Semitic remarks, which I actually didn't hear before.
Like what?
Like, neither with the Jews, right? The Horst Wessel Lied, the song of Horst Wessel was a song, and one sentence is, till the Jews' blood drips from our knives. And that was a shock for me, because I went to a public school. I would say all or most of my friends were not Jewish. In my particular class, we were only two Jews. All other children were Gentiles. Our Jewish education was once or twice a week for an hour or two. The Jewish children in this particular school, which is called Rheingasse Hauptschule, were brought together into one classroom, and an rabbi from the Jewish community came and gave us religious introduction. And I went only very infrequently to the temple, although I had bar mitzvah, and although my grandparents observed all the Jewish holidays. But my father and my close family was not really, you know, by no means Orthodox. We were more what is called Reformed Jews.
Incidentally, when religious study took place in the public schools when they called out the Jewish children for religious education. Did they ever call out any other children for, were there Lutherans called out or Catholics called out or?
No, they didn't. Austria is to the largest extent a Catholic country, and that is also the national religion, and all other religions were small minorities. I believe in Vienna by March 1938 there were only perhaps 200,000 Jews living.
And the rest were Catholic.
Right, most of them were Catholic.
For the most part.
Right.
When was the first time you experienced anti-Semitism? Had you never experienced it before March of 38 as a young child?
Well, I really don't recall that I ever experienced anti-Semitism. But now that you mentioned it, I remember there were a few German Jewish refugees coming to my father before the 1938 invasion of Austria. And they came from Germany and they told us many stories which neither he or I or everybody else really believed them. That was stories of beginning atrocities of Jews sent to detaining camps. They were really not called concentration camps at that time. But later on, we found that all those stories were true.
And what happened after March of 38? What specifically happened in your daily routine?
Well, very slowly we started to experience difficulties. Before the school really ended, I was already expelled.
How?
One day, during the classes, the director of the school came into the classroom and said, "All the Jewish children, stand up and leave. We don't want you anymore here."
Just like that?
Just like that. And that was the end of my public education.
What was the basis for him saying that?
The basis for him was that a directive came to have his school judenfrei, which means no Jews could go into the public school in Vienna. They had to go to a Jewish school, which was set up immediately thereafter, or perhaps a couple of weeks later, from the Jewish Israeli Kultusgemeinde.
This was for all the public schools in Vienna?
That's correct.
Austria?
That was for the high schools as well as for the lower schools.
So all of a sudden, in one day, the Jewish children who were in public school could not continue.
Were expelled.
And what was the reaction? Do you recall the reaction of your parents, of your family?
Well, of course, surprise. On the other hand, they also expected something to happen, because around the same time, signs were placed in the public gardens, Jews not allowed to sit on this particular bench. The movie theaters had signs, Jews not allowed. You could go in no theater, no public library would rent you a book. They didn't want Jews to contaminate their books. They the population changed. Or should I say, we heard many bad things thrown at us. And also, the Jews started to leave Austria. People which had means and people which had passports, because not everybody had a guilty passport at that time.
I'm sorry, had a what?
A travel document, passport, left to Italy, to Hungary, to Czechoslovakia, wherever they could go, Switzerland. The more mobile people, I would say, started to leave.
Let me just go back for one moment. How would a librarian know if a 15-year-old girl, for example, came in to take out a book on geography? How would she know she was Jewish?
Interesting enough, this question came up many times in my mind, and I can only tell you certain names are strictly Jewish, mm-hmm. or very, very much Jewish. The Austrian, just by looking at you, could also in many times tell if you're Jewish or not. And I think that was the beginning of the real anti-Semitism, which was prevailing always in Austria.
What about someone who had an ordinary name and yet who, for example, might, quote, look Jewish, and they came to the library and the librarian refused the book? How would that person have to prove that he was not a Jew in order to get the book?
I don't think, or sit on the park bench? I don't think so. I think that in the moment an directive came out and a sign was put up, the Jews were also afraid to go to a library or to cross the line and go into a movie theater when there was a sign Jews not allowed. Because at the same time, people started to get picked up and thrown into camps because they had previous political affiliations, or they were outspoken, or they had professions which the Germans didn't like. Like a reporter and a newscaster. I'm talking about Jewish newscasters.
Did your family know of anyone specifically what this happened to? They know of any families, or is
yes, just I have a cousin by the name of Otto Perl.
How do you spell it?
Otto Perl, mm-hmm. which was, I think, 4 or 5 years older than me. And in his youth, he joined the Red Falcon, which was a socialistic youth group. Not because he was a communist, just because his friends were in this particular group. When the German came to Austria, also socialistic groups were immediately prosecuted. And for example, my father was a social democrat. In the United States, there are only republics, only two. But in Austria, there were many parties, and that was one of them. And a lot of the leaders of this particular party were immediately imprisoned. I mentioned my father. My father was picked up on the street of Vienna on one day
By whom?
The Austrian police had Nazi arm stripes and were under the control at that time already under from German Nazis, closed up a street on both sides and took everyone which had Jewish identity cards.
In the what?
Had Jewish papers. You see, in Austria, everybody had to have an... when you go here to a bank, they ask you for your driver's license as a way of identifying yourself. But in Austria, you had also cards. And in the moment they saw that you are a Jew, they threw you in jail.
How could they see that you were a Jew?
Matter of fact, they were marked Mosaic Jewish religion.
So on a driver's license or identity card?
That was not the driver's license, it was an identity card, yes. Mm-hmm. And an interesting part is that at that time it was possible to get people out of prison and out of the concentration camps if you could show that they had an affidavit, a Yamada, and visa to emigrate immediately to out of Austria. And for example, my cousin Otto Pearl, his parents got him an entry permit to England, and after 2-3 months he was released from Dachau, and I remember seeing him without any hair, with the view out of his eyes of an person which went through a tremendous difficult time, and he had to immediately leave Austria. My mother was able to get my father free.
How was that?
The mail order business of my mother and father was taken over, what was called at that time arisiert, taken away from the rightful owner, and it was taken by 2 Austrian Nazis, one by the name of Krebs.
Spell it.
K-R-E-B-S. And the second one by the name of Magyar. M-A-G-Y-E-A-R. They took over the business.
How do you mean they took it over? Did he sell it to them?
Of course not.
Oh.
They came one day and they said, well, a Jew is not allowed to have a mail order business. We will run it.
That was a government proscription at that
right.
time?
And my father had to work for them without any salary for, I believe, 3 to 4 weeks to show them the business. Our employees just were taken over, the stock and the equipment, the office equipment and so on, were just taken. At the same time, we had to leave our apartment too.
Why?
The building we were living in on 14 Porzellangasse in the 9th district of Vienna was declared Judenrein, which means the owner didn't want to have any Jews renting apartments. So he wanted his building free of Jews. And that was very possible at that time. And the Jews living there could only take along the things they could carry. They had to leave all their furniture, all their belongings, where they were. And we moved in. I'm speaking about my father, my mother, and brother, and me, into an apartment owned by another Jewish family, which had, for example, an apartment of four rooms, and we moved into two rooms of her. I think that my mother could free my father because she could prove that he was still needed in the business run now by German owners or something, you know, that nature, which was an arisiertes business. And my father came home, I don't want to say a broken man, but he was changed in the few days, perhaps week and a half in prison. The building is called Rossauer Kaserne in the Vienna 9th District. They must have interrogated him in a very brutal fashion.
You don't know if he was touched or...
He never really spoke about that. Mm-hmm. Physically, we saw there was a change, a tremendous, physically as well as mentally. We, of course, tried also to leave Austria because there, you know, we saw there was no future in us, for us.
He was saying that she got the visa. How did she get a visa for him?
Well, I have to go back a little bit. In the First World War, my father had an officer's servant, which was an Austrian soldier by the name of Bauer, B-A-U-E-R. He came of the part of Tyrol. And after the war in 1920-22, the economic situation was very, very bad in Austria. And he tried to emigrate, leave Austria for Paraguay.
We'll continue this on the next tape. Thank you.
This is roll 2.
Robert, you were telling us about Bauer, the your father's assistant, or in World War I.
Yeah, he was actually the servant of my father. In the Austrian Imperial Army, an officer had always a servant, because an officer was not supposed to clean his shoes or something like that. Well, this Bauer and my father were always in contact with. And when the economic situation in the early 20s in Austria was very bad, he wanted to emigrate to Paraguay.
Why Paraguay?
Because in Paraguay, farmers were needed, and the Paraguayan government made commitments to Austrian farmers. If they would come over and farm certain lands for 10 years, they would give them the land. Mm-hmm. And a German-Austrian colony existed in Villa Rica, Paraguay. And my father made it possible for Bauer and his family to emigrate from Austria to Paraguay.
Did he have a large family?
He had a very large family, and not knowing, he actually made his fortune with his family because he had, I believe, 5 or 6 daughters, and 3 of the daughters were in the age of marriageable age, and when they came to Paraguay, they found many young Austrians there without wives and without possibilities of getting an European girl, and suddenly they found a family with girls coming in, and of course they were married in very short time, and Bauer had all the help he needed to build up his farm. And he was very grateful for the help my father could provide to him. And a matter of fact, he wrote once my father should send him a special water pump, and it took big efforts to get the water pump boat and sent from Austria to Paraguay. So when the time came of the release from prison, my father immediately got in contact with Bauer in Paraguay and asked him to send him a Yamada. A Yamada is an official immigration document similar to an certificate to go to Palestine, or a quota number to come to the United States. And Bauer immediately sent him a Yamada for my father, my mother, and the 2 children. And we would have been able to emigrate from Vienna almost immediately, because in the meantime, we made our passports, which were stamped with a large J, meaning Jew. And we got also all the necessary travel documents. And we even had ship tickets. I remember it was the Hapag going from Hamburg to Montevideo, and then Montevideo up the Parana to Asunción in Paraguay. But suddenly something came up. It came that my father had in Switzerland, in the little town of Wiel, not far, Wiel, W-I-L, not far from St. Gallen, machineries producing lace. And Swiss farmers, during the winter time when they had very little work to do, produced lace on large, long, special machineries for him. And of course, he had also money, Swiss money in Swiss banks. He had machinery, and he had a commerce between Switzerland and Austria. And when the Germans took the business away, they wanted this particular machinery which was a very delicate and special piece of equipment transferred from Switzerland, from Wiel, to Austria. And also they wanted the Swiss francs, which were in Swiss banks, transferred to Austria. So they did allow only, out of four passports, two passports for emigration. And because my father had this experience of imprisonment, and because my brother is 2 years older than me, at that time 19 years old, and because we as a family thought that they are the most, the people in bigger danger, we decided they should go first.
The Germans didn't want your father to remain to execute this transfer of funds and machinery?
They were very happy that my mother would be here doing it, because my mother worked with my father in the business. And my mother agreed to that.
They had such details on individuals that if a guy came into the consulate or wherever the passport house, that they would know his business, they would know what he did, what he owned, what they wanted from him?
Yes. Don't forget, my father had a registered business, and the books were always under control of CPAs. When the Germans took the books, when they took the business over, the books were available to them. All the records of export and import between Switzerland were legal. The bank books were in their hands, not in ours. The only need they had was signatures, actually, to transfer money, although time was necessary too. Machinery couldn't be shipped from day to the next. Unfortunately, what happened was that the war with Poland started. My father and brother left. The war with Poland was in September 1939, and they left, I would have to look it up exactly, but they left in March of 39. So they left a few months earlier. And of course, I should have mentioned that the real persecution of the Jews started with the Kristallnacht in Vienna and in Germany too. That was the time when the Germans really tightened up everything what was in Jewish hands.
That would have been beginning of November 1938, right?
Right. I forgot to mention that Jewish books were burned, that Jewish intellectuals were imprisoned immediately, that anything what you can think of was difficult. A Jewish woman was only allowed to go shopping between 3 and 5, and suddenly things which were on the shelves disappeared or were not sold to them. I remember as a child I couldn't go to a barber shop to have my hair cut. I had to go to a Jewish barber shop.
Why was
because
that?
The regular barber shop wouldn't cut a Jewish hair, contaminating his scissors. Times almost overnight, things started to change. Public transportation was strictly regulated. You couldn't travel anymore freely within Austria for everything documents were required. We had part of our family in Czechoslovakia, and we would have loved to go there, but it was impossible. They couldn't visit us either. And
excuse me, were they in eastern or western Czechoslovakia?
They were in a part of Moravia, which is the western part of Czechoslovakia.
Had they not been affected by Kristallnacht in western Czechoslovakia? Do you know?
They had been affected too, yes, of course. But what I wanted to say is the free travel didn't exist anymore. Mm-hmm. We couldn't move. Financially, the situation was very difficult for us too, because we suddenly found ourselves without money. We were, after my father and brother left, we were required to go into what was called the Viennese ghetto, the 2nd and 20th district was used to concentrate all the Viennese Jews living out in the other districts. And I had to go and live with an uncle of mine. My mother, in order to earn money, had to go to work in households of more better situated Jewish families. And I took a few courses given by the Jewish community in order to learn trades. And I also started to get in contact with the Jewish youth groups, because don't forget, we couldn't go into parks, we couldn't go into the Wiener Woods, we couldn't ride the public transportations, we had actually nothing to do, so we met in the home of the Jewish youth groups, which was in the first district in the Mark Aurel Straße 5, and it was called UI.
How do you spell it?
J-U-L, Jewish Youth Group or something like that. And every Jewish youth group had a little room there, and we met. And that is actually the first time I met Aaron Mentzer. And
this is a man?
Yes, that was a young man. I believe he was perhaps 5 or 6 years older than me.
Can you say his name and spell it for us again?
Aaron, A-R-O-N, Mentzer is M-E-N-Z-E-R. And we belonged to different groups. There was Betar, and there was Hashomer Tzair, and there was Gordonia, and there was, Mizrahi. But for us, that was not very important. And I joined the Hashomer Tzair, not because I really liked it, because my friends were there.
Who was this Aaron Mentzer?
Aaron Mentzer was an student. He was Jewish, I don't want to say intellectual, but he was an well-educated young man, which made it his business to run or supervise those Jewish children which came to the UI, came to this building, which was set up by the Jewish community as an recreational center for the children, for the Jewish children, so the children are not always at home and they couldn't be on the streets, so they should be in certain classrooms. And Aaron Menzer had the idea of teaching them, first of all, Judaism, because most of those children were, like me, from assimilated families. And that was the first time when we heard about Jewish songs, when we learned how to dance a hora, a traditional Jewish dance, when we heard about Jewish riders, or when we heard about the history of immigration into Palestine, the first building of kibbutzim. And he slowly introduced us to the idea of Zionism. He was instrumental in creating a garden, or taking over a garden which was owned by Rothschild in the outskirts of Vienna, and made a small beginning of a hachshara.
What is a hachshara?
Hachshara is is the idea of group teaching children or teenagers how to live from the land, which means work in the garden, produce vegetables, have perhaps a cow, how to milk a cow, which was very strange for us. And by the way, the vegetables produced in this particular garden went to the Jewish hospital called the Billroth Hospital in Vienna, and where we actually did productive work because of that. In the meantime, many things happened. Suddenly I found out an uncle or an aunt were gone. They were just emigrating to Australia. Or another one was taking the opportunity and went to the United States, had the opportunity to go to the United States. That was, I'm talking about the time just before the war in Poland, 1939. So slowly, part of my family disappeared.
Were there many Austrian, Viennese Jews or Austrian Jews who were able to emigrate?
Yes.
Many who had visas?
Yes. In matter of fact, more than half of the original 200,000 managed to leave Austria before September of 1938.
How do you know that?
Most of my family left, and I know that records were kept, and of course, suddenly you saw an emptiness around you. Faces you knew were gone, and when you asked, what happened with so-and-so, oh, he got an affidavit, or he got on a children's transport to England or to Sweden. Some of those people, unfortunately, left and were caught a second time, because they left and went to Hungary, or they left and went to Czechoslovakia, or left and went to Yugoslavia. Some of them had the relatives which made it possible to them. So a large portion of people left. I had also a cousin working in the Kultusgemeinde in Vienna, and he worked in a particular department of the Kultusgemeinde, which had all the records of the Jewish people of Vienna.
What was his name?
His name was Ernst Weiss. And me having nowhere to go, I lived with his father and mother in their apartment. And one day he came to me and he said, "Bob, the Germans requested lists from us. I think it would be a good idea if you would go and voluntarily say you want to go into the Arbeitsdienst, which is called the workers, that you want to work for them."
For the Germans.
For the Germans. And I did this. And I was I got a postcard. I had to go to the Gestapo headquarters in the Prinz Eugen Straße on a certain date, on a certain time, which I did. I was, I believe, not even 17 at that time. And suddenly I found myself in the courtyard, assembled with perhaps close to 400 other Jews. And a very famous German, I shouldn't say German, he was an Austrian, SS man came by the name of Eichmann. Hmm. And he held a little speech. And he said, "Now you will to the assembled Jews. Now you will enter the trucks on the outside, and we will bring you to the labor camps. We have opened up for you." And one was on the Leubel Pass in Carinthia, I remember. And another one was in another small town. I have the name on my lips, but right now I cannot find the name. And a list was read, and suddenly the 400 people slowly were loaded up on trucks, and the trucks left. And left over standing in the courtyard was another young fella, and the only thing what I remember about him was that he had only 9 fingers. That was another thing interesting. He said, "Show us your hands. You never worked in your life. Now we will teach you how to work." That was Eichmann.
Eichmann said this to you?
To all us, all of us. And that is the way I remember the young fellow next to me when he showed his hands. He had only 9 fingers. I don't know his name, but I will never forget his hands. And to us too, he said, "You are the only ones which volunteered, and you will work in Vienna." And we got working papers. The next day I had to go to a construction company. And I remember the first job I had was in the in a building which had water in the cellar, and they took the water out. It was the Landwirtschaftliche Versuchsanstalt in Vienna. That was a government building. And later on we worked in different other buildings. The situation about food, I wanted to tell you also, became very critical. Everything was in strict ration cards, and the Jewish ration cards were marked J, and red J. And many things the German or the Austrian were able to purchase were not free for the Jews. We were also very restricted on the time of we could go into the stores. And money was very scarce for a lot of people at the time, because the Germans took a lot of money. They took all our jewelry. We had to give up all jewelry. The only thing what a woman was left to wear was the wedding band. So the Austrian Jewish community made soup kitchens. And the soup kitchens were for them available in the hospitals and old age homes, and they used them, and they fed actually the Jewish population in Vienna. And I remember every day, once a day, you picked up with a little pail your food ration.
Who funded that?
That's a very good question. In Austria, there were also very rich Jews. When they left, they were only allowed to take 10 marks with them. So a suggestion was made to them, perhaps a little bit a forceful one, from the Jewish community, that you have to contribute your money, you cannot take anyway with you, mm-hmm. to the support of those Jews which don't have any more financial help.
We're going to continue this on the following tape so we don't interrupt you. Thank you.
EISS, this is rule 3.
Robert, you were telling us about how the wealthy Jews of Vienna funded the soup kitchen because they couldn't take any money more than 10 marks. Incidentally, what do you surmise 10 marks would be equivalent to in the American dollar of 1996?
Well, perhaps in the best way it would be $10.
$10.
Right. I forgot to mention, the soup kitchen produced an one-pot meal, which was a little bit a thicker soup. I don't want that you think that was a dinner served. It was just a one-pot meal, and also you got a slice of bread. The bread was very restrictive. I believe it was 100 gram a day per person. So you try to save part of the bread for the morning breakfast or for the evening, because when you ate it, it was all you had. And I remember my mother tried to doctor up the meal with a little bit whatever she could get otherwise too. And I remember also that from that time on, I believe for years to come, I was always hungry. It was my growing years, and I needed perhaps more. Another thing I would like to mention, clothes. It was very hard for us to get anything new to buy. Shoes, almost impossible.
If you weren't allowed to buy in the Gentile stores, and you weren't allowed.
We were not allowed to buy at all. So what we did, we bartered. We bartered with other Jews. It was an giving and take. My free time, I forgot to tell you too, that we worked 6 days. Not like here, 40 hours. We worked perhaps 10 hours a day, 6 days a week, and we had only the Sunday free. And the Sundays I always spent in the UAL, in the group of Aaron Mentzer. And I met a lot of Jews in my age group, girls and boys. And that was actually the happiest times I had with them for a few hours, because when I had to go home, it was depressing. And when I had to work, I was living in a different world. So coming back on Sunday, that was the time I looked always forward to.
When you were doing this in the community center, was that before or during the time you registered and for the Germans and Eichmann found two of you left? Is that before?
No, that was after. Because I worked, actually, I was not working in a work camp. I was sleeping at home. I had to come only every morning to the workplace, and every evening I had to leave.
So after he gave you, or he arranged for you and the nine-fingered man to have papers, you walked out of this courtyard,
right,
and you were, quote, free to go to work.
Free, under quotation marks, because I had to go the next day to an German construction firm, which took me as a worker, as an unpaid worker, as a laborer, for nothing. But I was under the control of the Gestapo, because I had to be every morning there. They had records, and I had to work 6 days a week. And I was only allowed to go home in the evening to sleep. And only my Sunday was free. That was actually the biggest privilege we had.
How long did that go on?
It went till a few days before November 21st, 1941, when I left Austria and escaped to Yugoslavia.
In 41?
41. November the 21st, 1941. And that I would like to tell you a little bit more about. When my cousin Ernst came to me and said, "Bob, my family is leaving for Shanghai on the Trans-Siberian Railway from Vienna to Harbin and from Harbin to Shanghai. You have to leave, and I have to give you some other news. Your name came up on the next list of the transport to Poland.
What did you know of these transports to Poland, you and your family?
We knew quite a bit. First of all, we knew that the Viennese Gestapo asked the Jewish community, the Kultusgemeinde, for lists, and particularly lists in 1,000 names. And he, working in the department which had all those lists, they were actually compiling the lists for the Gestapo.
The Jewish Cultural Center?
No, the Jewish Israeli Kultusgemeinde. The UL was only part of that.
Right.
And Ernst worked in the department of the, it was called the Kartothek. And the earliest transports from Vienna to Theresienstadt, which was not Auschwitz or was not the camps in Poland, but was an central holding camp in Czechoslovakia. The earliest ones were in October of 1941. He came to me and he says, "Bob, your name came up in one of the lists. You have to leave." And on the same evening, or the next morning, I went to Aaron Menzer. I didn't go to work. I went to Aaron Menzer. And I said to him, "This has happened. I'm losing in a few days my quarters where I have my bed, because my family is going with the Trans-Siberian Railway to Shanghai. I have the knowledge to Ernst, my cousin, that my name is in the next list of a transport to Poland." And Aaron Menzer, at that time, had a way of smuggling out Jews out of his group, young Jews, to Yugoslavia.
How did you know that about Aaron?
About Aaron? I tell you, a lot of the children coming to him lost their fathers in the concentration camps. By concentration camps at that time was Dachau and Buchenwald, concentration camps in Germany. So they were already half orphans. Of some of them, the mothers disappeared. Out of certain reasons, I really don't know, and they were full orphans. And Aaron had now the responsibility of feeding them, giving shelter to them at night and at day. And Aaron was looking for ways to get those children out of his hands. And he found an SA man, living in Graz, which had a restaurant and a pig farm, by the name of Schleich.
Spell it, can you?
S-C-H-L-E-I-C-H.
And he was with the Austrian SA?
He was actually an Austrian Nazi.
Mm-hmm.
With the brown shirts, which was called SA. And he had an arrangement with Aaron, or with the UI, that he would take a Jew for 600 mark and send him, which under the guidance of smugglers he knew, to Yugoslavia. And Aaron did send children in the age from 15 to 17 which were orphans, which were actually on his, under his supervision, in groups of 10, in groups of 8, to Graz, to this guy by the name of Schleich, and they came to Yugoslavia.
But how did you know about Aaron's doing this?
I knew a lot of friends of mine, which I saw and had contact with, just were not there anymore the next day, or in the next week when I came, they were not here anymore. And when I asked, you know, where is so-and-so, they said, oh, Aaron sent him this transport to Yugoslavia. So I had the knowledge already that that existed.
So within the Jewish community center, a cultural center, there were plenty of people who knew that Aaron Mensah was doing this. Is
yes.
That, yeah,
I see. Not only that, Aaron Mensah had no money. Mm-hmm. He was a very sincere fellow. And everything he owned, he gave actually to the children. He worked without salary. Mm-hmm. And the money he needed to send the children, because Schleich wanted 600 marks per person, Aaron got from the Jewish community center, from the Jewish Israelitic Kultusgemeinde, and they paid actually, they gave him the money so that he could pay Schleich. It was not Aaron Mensah's money, it was the collective money of the Jewish community which made it possible for those escapes.
I don't want to leave the subject of the Polish transport. Just tell me what you think the community, your community, yourself, your mother, your friends, your relatives knew about transports to Poland that was perhaps different than transports to Theresienstadt or Buchenwald. What did that mean to you?
We knew that a large camp exists in Theresienstadt. Don't forget, at that time, mail service existed between the camp of Theresienstadt and the families in Vienna. We got letters from people which were deported to Theresienstadt asking, for example, about members in the family and asking also if it would be possible to send them money or send them food, which we didn't have anyway, but send them parcels. Every letter was censored, which means it was opened and closed by a paper stripe from the German authorities. Yet, sometimes, when family members sent money to Theresienstadt, we knew from other letters returning that they got the money. So we knew about conditions in Theresienstadt. Dachau and Buchenwald, also people were allowed to write a postcard a month and were allowed to receive a postcard back. So we knew about certain conditions. They were not able to tell us in words we were beaten or we were badly treated. But they knew how to write certain things, and we knew how to read between lines. And we knew also that in Poland, different camps existed, because out of certain camps we never got any answers back. There was no mail service to Auschwitz.
But did that necessarily mean anything other than the fact that there was no mail service?
No. We only heard rumors. Unsubstantiated rumors. But at that time, we rather started to believe those rumors.
Why?
Because we knew how the Germans acted. We knew how the people were treated. And people which came back out of the concentration camps, like my cousin von Dachau, he told us certain things. He didn't tell anything. He didn't want to go in much detail, but we started to get the message.
So that when you had the opportunity to go to Aaron Mensah, you took it.
I took it, and I also asked him very, very sincerely, Aaron, please help me. I don't want to go to Poland. And by the way, I'm not alone. I have my mother. And, you know, I cannot leave her. And he did. He said, okay, I know your situation. And he made it possible for me to go to Schleich. Now, that is not as easy as I tell you. Because at that time, no Austrian Jew was allowed to go on a railroad. And Vienna and Graz is quite a distance. So we had to take an us to go illegally on the railroad. We had to buy tickets. We had to...
How did you do that? I am interested in that.
Of course, there were controls on the railway stations. But we were also able to slip by controls. And Aaron told us certain ways how to do that. And that was why he was able to send the children to go. And when he told us only about Schleich and his address of the restaurant in Graz.
Are you talking about you and your mother?
Right.
Anybody else?
Yes, my aunt and cousin came with us. And when we reached Schleich, the restaurant, he told us about the pig farm he had in the vicinity of Graz. And he brought us to the pig farm. But we didn't know anything else.
Down the line.
Down the line.
When you took the train from Vienna to Graz, the four of you.
Yes.
Did you carry baggage with you? Did you have papers with you?
I'm glad that you asked me that. I took only a handbag. But I put on two shirts, and I had a pullover, and I tried to wear as much as underwear as I could. And my mother did the same, and of course everybody else, because nothing else we could take along with us. And like I said, I mentioned to you, we had passports too. When we came to Graz, we found that the restaurant was a beer hall. How should I say? A very small, wine cellar. Or, you know, it was not a restaurant, what you may think as a big restaurant or something like that. It was a small restaurant. And this guy immediately knew who we were and took us to his pig farm.
How?
He had one of the deliberate small trucks at that time, and we were already, I believe, five or six people at the time in this little room in the restaurant, because we were not alone.
Others joined you?
Others joined us.
Had they been with you on the train?
No.
No.
And we didn't know about that.
I see.
But suddenly, somebody else came into the room, somebody else. And most of the people which came in the room were children from Aaron Mensah. And I didn't know that Aaron Mensah sent them. And some of them I knew from Vienna. Some of them were German children.
From where would they have been?
You see, Aaron Mensah had a pipeline also from Berlin, from Gelsenkirchen, from Frankfurt am Main, from other German communities where Jews still existed. And they sent their children, which had no parents, to Vienna because they somehow knew about this line to Yugoslavia. I was on this pig farm for perhaps 2 days. I don't recall anymore. The whole way to Yugoslavia took 5 or 6 days. And I must say, Schleich brought us food. It was perhaps better than the soup kitchen from the Kultusgemeinde. And then one day, he came and he said, today we go to Spielbergstrasse, which was the border town between Austria, Carinthia, and Yugoslavia at that time. And I will bring you to a farmer, which is a smuggler. And this farmer smuggled saccharin and cigarettes for years back, even before Hitler occupied Austria, he was already a smuggler, to Yugoslavia. And he brought back certain things that I don't know. And he was very familiar about the border. And the border in Spielbergstrasse, the border I'm talking about, is not the road, it's the mountains, it's the woods, it's for me the wilderness. And don't forget, I left on 21st of November. I was in Spielbergstrasse perhaps on the 23rd of November. That was November 41, a very harsh winter, high snow and cold. And by no means I had shoes for those conditions. I had regular shoes only and regular clothes. So when we reached Spielbergstrasse and he gave us into the hands of this Austrian farmer. We were brought into a little room. He had straw on the floor. And he said, we will cross the border during the night. And we will go in single file. I will be the leader. The next one will go after me and after me and after me. And if you lose the person in front of you, that's it. And it will be night. It will be very difficult. Don't take anything with you.
And you were a group of Viennese.
We were
citizens.
At that time perhaps 12 people, or perhaps 14. By the way, on the same farmer, on the same day, I met a boy my age by the name of Manny Isler. Isler, Isseler. And this boy was from the group of Aaron Menzer. He damaged his ankle and he had to stay back. And why I mention him to you is because he's from Gelsenkirchen, a German. He was very religious. He was strictly kosher. He laid his tefillin every day. And my mother had 10 marks, and I had 10 marks, and we bartered the 10 marks for eggs with the farmer. And we had the eggs hard-boiled, because that was the only thing he would eat. And we left him the eggs. During the night, around 11 or 12, the farmer picked us up.
Did you ever know his name, the farmer's name?
No. I may have known. But I don't remember anymore. The name of Schleich will always stay with me. The name of Aaron Menzer will always stay with me. But certain names I don't remember. And we went on a trek to the mountains, to the snow, to the woods. And we came after a few hours of walking under the most strenuous conditions. And we were not very strong at that time. And I remember a lot of people threw their baggage, whatever they had, away. We came to an area where he said, this is the frontier. On one side, German guards walking. And on the other side, the people walking are already Yugoslavian soldiers. We have to wait for a time period when there is nobody here, and then we cross.
How old was the youngest in that group of 14?
In the youngest was perhaps 12, 13 years old, and the oldest was around my mother, my aunt's age, I would say, let's say 40. Mm-hmm. And we crossed, and we walked again for another hour, hour and a half, and we came to the town of Maribor.
Let's wait until we switch tapes, and we'll continue with Maribor. Thank you, Bob. We were talking about Maribor, Yugoslavia.
Right. And the smuggler brought us to an large building on the outskirts of the town, and a door opened, and we found us in a courtyard. And a man was waiting for us, and his name, I will also never forget, was Markus Rosner.
R-O-S-N-E-R.
Markus Rosner. And Yugoslavian Jew living in Maribor, which out of the goodness of his heart took in all the Jews crossing over from Austria. And not only Austrian Jews, there were German Jews, there were some from other parts like Yugoslavia, took them in and sent them on the way to Zagreb, because Maribor was too close to the border to stay. And the community, the Jewish community of Maribor, was too small. They couldn't absorb that many people.
And when you arrived in this house with the courtyard, did you get any water and food?
Oh, yes. Yeah, I must say, he really made us as comfortable as he could. As a matter of fact, I remember we washed. We were very, very dirty.
He was alone, Markus Rosner?
No. He had a wife, and he had a larger family. I don't remember anymore.
But they helped as well.
They helped as well. Either they were his servants or were his children. I really don't know. I was only there a very short time, a few hours.
I see.
We freshed up. We got food. And he rented taxis, and in groups of four or five, we were brought from Maribor quite a distance to Zagreb and to the Jewish community, to the Israelitish center of Zagreb. And of course, they knew already from our coming. Apparently, they were he notified them. So they knew already. And they had a very good system of taking care of refugees. They had a lot of poor Jewish Yugoslav families living in Zagreb under the help of the Jewish community.
Were they Yugoslavian Jews?
Yes, I'm talking about Yugoslavian Jews. So they told them, we give you a family, or we give you two, three refugees. You put them up in one of your rooms, and you provide minimal breakfast and food, and we pay you. And this way, my mother and I, we got a shelter in Opatovina Ulica, that is Opatovina Street, in the upper part of Zagreb, with an old Jewish couple. And also we had no difficulties in speaking with them because they spoke German.
How is that?
This part of Yugoslavia, Zagreb and even Belgrade, was Austrian territory before the First World War. Even the First World War started in Sarajevo, if you remember. And of course, those old people, they went to Austrian schools, and German was their language at that time. Perhaps not the first language, but the second language. So we had no difficulty in speaking with them. And also Rosner spoke German. But for example, the taxi driver, we couldn't converse with him because we couldn't understand him.
What section of Yugoslavia, what province was this, Zagreb? Was this Slovenia?
No, Maribor is Slovenia.
Yes.
Is located in Slovenia. Zagreb is located in Croatia. Later on, we found out that the biggest anti-Semites in Yugoslavia are the Ustashi in Zagreb. If I could back up one moment, I mentioned Otto Perl, a cousin of mine, came back from Dachau, and his parents bought him the ticket to go to England, and he was interned in England on the Isle of Man. But his parents didn't survive, and I was still in Vienna when my aunt Martha Pearl committed suicide with gas in their kitchen on the day she got the notification of her being picked up for the Poland transport.
Poland.
And on the next day, when the truck arrived to pick them up, my uncle Paul Pearl, Otto's father, had a heart attack and died on the at the moment when he had to enter the truck.
On the street.
On the street. He was laying on the street for a day and a half, till the Bnei Brit, the Jewish burial society, picked him up and gave him a burial, because the Austrian didn't really care.
You were still
that living. Was when I still was in Vienna. I forgot to mention it before. I think I should have mentioned it.
Go on with the taxis.
Well, like I said, the taxis arrived in Zagreb in intervals. Rosner didn't send them out together. He sent them out in hourly intervals. And all the Jews which crossed the border were brought to Zagreb and were accommodated the same way like we were. None of them had any money. Most of them had no clothes other than they could carry. And I must say the Yugoslav community took very good care of us. A few days later, I met Joshko Indek.
Who is that?
I tried to find a similar group like I had in Vienna with Aaron Menzer, also in Zagreb, which means I wanted to be with the same age group people, and I wanted to, I didn't know anybody, I couldn't speak the language, I had no money, so the only way of entertainment or of being with people of the same thinking was with a youth group. And I went to the Israelitic Kultus Gemeinde and they told me, here is a house where the Jewish children congregate. And the Jewish children had a person which is called Madrir, that is the leader of a group. And the leader of the group at that time was Joshko Indek.
Could you spell that for us, Rabbi? Joshko?
Joshko is J-O-S-C-H-K-O. Indek is I-N-D-I-G, Indek.
He was Yugoslavian?
He was a Yugoslavian student. He was not much taller than me. He had a pronounced long nose, I remember, and he spoke fluently German. Later on, I found out he came from a very religious background. His parents, his father and his mother were Orthodox Jews, and he may have rebelled a little bit because he joined the Hashomer Hatzair, which is an leftish youth group, and when he saw the necessity of helping the children coming from Austria and Germany, he started to bring them together. The Jewish community in Zagreb gave them a building, and most of the orphans actually lived in this building. They had their beds there, they had their kitchen facilities and so on. And he started a small school. The studies were more Jewish and Palestine directed than in regular schools. I remember I heard the first time Ivrit, the language of Israel today, spoken and taught from Joshko Indek in Zagreb. What he did is actually very similar what Aaron Menzer did in Vienna. He congregated all the children. He tried to occupy them during the day, and he gave his time. For the adults was a different different story, had different interests, and we were not very much interested in, you know, in that life.
What were Yashko Indig's plans for all these children? Was there enough? More people keep coming to him?
Yashko Indig, the Jewish community, Recha Freya, which was a German woman, they tried to collect all the children coming the pipeline down from Germany and Austria, sent by Aaron Menzer to Schleich, to Graz, Spielbergstrasse, Marburg, Rosner, to Zagreb. At that time, there was still freedom in Yugoslavia, because the Germans occupied Yugoslavia in April of 1941, and I arrived in the late part of November,
1940.
So we had 4 months of freedom in Yugoslavia. During those 4 months, transports were organized from the Yugoslavian Jewish community, which means they rented or they bought ships on the Danube. By ships, please don't think big ships. I meant very small paddle wheelers, which went down the Danube to the Black Sea, made their way to the Bosporus, to Turkey, and finally tried to get to Palestine. It was under the British mandate, and they had a terrible policy of holding up the Jews. But a few ships made it. And the Jewish community, Yashko Indig, they tried to organize transports. And they concentrated, let's say, 100 children or 20 adults, a little boat, a little ship, a willing captain with a lot of money that was not cheap. They didn't do it out of their goodness of their hearts. And in matter of fact, the last transport of 94 children, I was still there when they went to Belgrade and to the boat on the Danube. And every one of those 94 children made it to Palestine. I met them in Palestine. They were very active in the creation of the State of Israel. Unfortunately, this open door closed on the day Germany occupied Yugoslavia in April of 1941. From that moment on, there was no escape going down the Danube, because the war started with Greece, Turkey, and this opening closed. I forgot to tell you, too, in the 4 months period of time of liberty, my mother and I were able to get in contact with my father in South America. My father died shortly thereafter in 1941, but at that time we got, I believe, 2 letters from him back. And of course that closed, too, when Germany occupied Yugoslavia. The mail didn't exist anymore. But we had at least twice the occasion to get a letter. With the German occupation of Yugoslavia, our life changed too, because now the prosecution of the Jews started. And when the Yugoslavian Jews were in this entrapment and were very under very bad condition, you can imagine how we were. We were there without any money and without any papers and without any support at all. So the only support I had was actually this little door open which was helped by Joschko Indik in his little group. In the meantime, we were close to 40 children, which he couldn't manage to get out anymore.
How many adults were there?
There were eight or ten adults, including my mother. Mm-hmm. And one of the adults by the name of Mr. Arveen was the cook, for example. I don't want to say he was a real cook, but he cooked for us.
In Zagreb?
In Zagreb. And my mother took over the... they had a sewing machine, and they had girls there too, teenager girls. So they took care of our clothes. They washed our clothes, they ironed our clothes, they mended our clothes, made sweaters and things like that. So my mother was in charge of this little group. Situation was getting worse daily. The Ustashi was getting very pronounced anti-Jewish. Groups were taken, 300 Yugoslavian Jews were taken in the age group from, let's say, 16 to 24, and were brought to a camp and just, we heard later on massacred. And we were still there and heard about things like that. Jasenovac was one of those terrible camps. So Joschko had now 40 children, 8 or 10 adults. Money was very short and running out because now the rich Yugoslavian Jews tried to escape left and right. They tried to escape to Hungary because they thought perhaps in Hungary the situation is a little bit better. And they were not willing to support us. They were not able, I shouldn't say willing. They most probably wanted to, but they were not able to. So something else happened at the time, that the Germans were very much occupied with the war in Greece. The war with Russia started in September of 1941. Troops had to be diverted. So they started to split up Yugoslavia. By splitting up, I mean they made an Italian-occupied area and a German-occupied area. And the Italian-occupied area was in Slovenia. And the Jews have a very easy way of getting to know things. And the Italians were better to the Jews than the Germans. So what happened is we tried to go to the Italian-occupied area. And Joschko got in contact with Yugoslavian Jews in Ljubljana. And in matter of fact, the name of one I will never forget was Bolafio.
Spell it, please.
B-O-L-A-F-F-I. I just found out that the father of Bolafio was a very famous painter. And both brother Bolafio, one was Eugene and one was, don't remember it right now, they were wine merchant, very well very rich wine merchants in Ljubljana.
Jewish.
And out of mitzvah and out of their good heart, they were able to rent an house by the name of Grad Lesmer Brudo.
Are you going to have to spell that for us, Robert?
G-R-A-D. L-E-S-N-O-B-R-D-O.
Can you say it again?
Grad Lesno Brdo. In the vicinity of Hoyul, H-O-R, J-U-L, perhaps 15 to 20 kilometers in the east of Ljubljana. That was an empty house, and he rented it for us. And Joshko told us the only way I can do is I bring you from Zagreb to Ljubljana. At that time, the railway existed, and we just went on. We had only the papers to show that we had a rental house in Grad Lesnobrodo. We had no travel papers at all. But in the meantime, the group of 42, 48 children and the 10 adults, the children were in an age group from 8 to 17. And most of them were now orphans. So one day we traveled, and we made it to Ljubljana. And on the border crossing, the Italian troops, they were very friendly to us. In the moment we heard, they heard orphany, oh, they didn't care about papers.
You said the border crossing. This border was between
the border was
German
between Germany, German occupied. That was not really a border anymore. That was more a military zone. It was the military zone between German occupied areas, because Yugoslavia was occupied by German, and Italian occupied areas. Good. And we made it to Lesnobrodo. And in Lesnobrodo, Joshko was able to continue the idea of Hakshara, which means preparation to the life of a person in Palestine, in a kibbutz. And he did it with the help of a few people, like Mr. Avin. He was our cook. He was also our cook in Lesnobrodo. With the help of my mother, which took care of laundry, clothes, and so on. With the help of a German professor by the name of Dr. Boris Jochwitzon, a German Jew, and he was a pianist by profession, but he had a vast knowledge in many, many things. And Marco was another adult which was in charge of buying food and bringing stuff to us, and a few other ones which helped in the group. And he started classes. We had regular school classes, actually, there.
This Lesnobrodo was a house?
Yes.
A manor house?
It was a small manor house. It was empty for many years, and it was used previously, and I'm talking about now perhaps 80 years back, when the Austrian, before the First World War, when they had royalty, it was used by them as an location. But for us, it was God sent, and we had even a little garden there where vegetables were grown.
You arrived Grad Lesno, I'm sorry, I can't pronounce it.
Lesnobrodo.
In what month of 1941?
It may have been August.
And how long were you there?
We would have stayed there for the end of the war, till the end of the war. Unfortunately, the Yugoslav people started to revolt against the German occupation. The partisans started to become very active under Tito. And in our area, the partisan group was under the command of an Yugoslavian by the name of Cerny.
Let's hold the rest of that history until we get to the another tape. We were trying to figure out the partisans and the situation that drew you in.
Lesnobruda was a beautiful setting. We had a little house, a small castle, I would say, on the tip of a little mountain, and we looked down into a valley. And we were surrounded by high mountains, all with beautiful trees, and very, very small farms, and self-sustaining farms, which means the farmers really didn't need anything. Perhaps they need shoes and clothes, but the rest, food, stuff, they had themselves. And that was very, very important at that time, because we had nothing to eat. And in an legitimate way, buying food was only possible with very restrictive cards. So we developed something. We sent out teenagers, me and other boys and girls, to the farmers, and we had to go farther and farther and farther, and we bought potatoes. Because don't forget, money we had more than food. We bought potatoes, and we bought, for example, eggs, and we bought carrots, and we bought farm products, and we brought them back to our place. And in order to get more money, we developed an little line to Ljubljana, and we actually sold surplus eggs and butter and potatoes to the people in Ljubljana, which were also short on food. So we had a barter going on. We got shoes and we got clothes for a few eggs and so on. And that worked out pretty well. We were still hungry, we were still not overfed, but the political situation changed. Suddenly we heard about shootings. Suddenly during the night we were standing on the balcony and we saw on one mountain fires, and then on the second one, and the next day we heard this farmer house was burned by the Italian troops because they had supported the partisans, and this house was burned by the partisans because this farmer sold food to the Italians, and we were more or less in the middle of fighting, starting to getting worse by day. And finally, one day, the partisans came. They came to us. And Joshko, of course, is fluent in the Yugoslavian language, and he told them about our situation, and they were very supportive about us. More so when they heard that we are not friendly with the Germans at all, because they thought German, they didn't understand Jews. Mm. For them, Jews was a, for this a Jew, they had no idea, but they knew we were German, but we were Austrian. So finally, they realized that we were prosecuted. And then they brought us food. And then a friendlier relationship started to begin with the partisans, with Czerny, their leader.
Who was it?
Czerny, that was his name.
Can you spell it?
It is not easy for me. It's S-Z-R-N-Y. I think there's a thing like this on top of the S or something. Czerny. In the meantime, the Italian troops in the same area found out that the partisans are in the area too, and they started to make swipes, and they came also to us. And they said, are the partisans in this area? And we said, of course, no. And as a matter of fact, one day we had a wounded partisan hiding upstairs. But the situation went from good to bad. I must also tell you that some of the farmers had radios, and those radios were able to listen to the BBC. So at that time, we had already knowledge from BBC, and I remember the Victory, you know, the signals and so on, and we knew how the political situation or the war was going on.
How old were you at this time?
I was perhaps 18 now. And finally, we got the notification from the Italian provincial government that they intend us to be moved to Italy proper in internment. Now, this is not freedom like we have in Gradlesno Brdo, but this is internment in a little village by the name of Nonantola, in the vicinity of Modena. But before we could leave Lesno Brdo, we had also to get permission from the partisans to cross their line. And the partisans at that time, they wanted the older children, boys and girls, to join them. In a matter of fact, one of our girls joined them by the name of Lilith Newman, and she was later on killed. She and another one were the only person we lost during the whole time for the war. When Joshko made Czerny see our situation, Czerny took the barricades away. What I forgot to tell you is that the partisans, when the fighting with the Italians started, they cut down all the trees on the road going to Horjul, to the main area. We were an isolated building, and the houses were in a little area called Horjul. But the road, the partisans closed by cutting down all the trees, and the trees were laying over the road. That way they prevented the Italian cars coming up certain roads. They made barriers. So Czerny, when he saw the necessity of letting us go, he gave the farmers in the area the order to open up the barricades, pull the trees apart so that we could go through, and then later on, they put the barricades up again.
Did you walk down the mountain?
We walked, and we had one of their horse-drawn carriages for our belongings. And we went to Ljubljana, and we were put on one railroad car, and we were hooked up to the train, and the train went from Ljubljana to Postumia Grotte to Trieste, and from Trieste up Bologna to Modena. And an interesting thing is that the Germans knew about our group too.
How do you know that?
Because they requested the Italian government, the Italian local government, when they requested the wagon, the railway car for us, to send the car instead of Trieste, Bologna, Modena, to Treviso and up to Germany. And their request was actually denied by the Italian government.
They wanted you back in Germany.
Right. And when we arrived in Modena after, I think, a day or day and a half long journey, the Modena Jewish community, they have a beautiful temple there, took us into their temple and provided food and shelter. Well, the children were exhausted at that time.
Obviously, there was contacts between cities, between Jewish community centers, between Joshko, Indik, and the Modena Jewish community. Do you know how those took place, those contacts?
I forgot to tell you. Joshko and our group of 10 adults, I should say. Joshko was the main, and he perhaps was the brain of the group. You know, he was the giving the directions. But we always had contact with the outside world. And this is an amazing fact. We were in contact in when we were in Lesnobrodo in 41, in 42, with Switzerland, with the only shaliach in whole Europe in Switzerland.
Would you explain what a shaliach is?
Shaliach is a Jew sent from Palestine, from one Jewish community, from one of the kibbutzim, to Europe on sometimes not very legal ways. And he has the order to help other Jews. And I would say he has also the unlimited financial power. By unlimited, I mean he had the ways of getting money from the United States, from South America, from Palestine, from Turkey, from any other ways. He had the facility, and he had also the order to give out this money to anybody in Europe requesting help.
And this shliach in Switzerland was?
If you give me 1 second, I have it.
Sure. And they made contact with him.
We made contact with him, and we were in written contact, sometimes not direct. Sometimes devious notes were sent. But they knew from our existence, and they diverted money from Switzerland to Yugoslavia, and diverted money also from Switzerland to Italy, where we were in Italy, and they supported us very, very well.
The that's all right. We'll come to that later.
Mm-hmm.
When you were now in Modena, what transpired there?
The Jewish community under Della Sem, the Jewish community under the name of Della Sem.
What is Della Sem?
Della Sem is the same thing like the Israelite Kultusgemeinde in Zagreb was the Israelitische Hilfsorganisation in Italy, mm-hmm. located in Geneva, in Genoa. And the man in Switzerland, in Geneva, his name is Nathan Schwalb. And he was a member of a kibbutz in Israel.
Do you know the name of the kibbutz? Remember that?
I would have to...
How do you spell Nathan Schwalb?
S-C-H-W-A-L-B, Nathan.
Great. And he was the shaliach?
He was the shaliach, yeah. And we had another man by the name of Lichtheim, Dr. Lichtheim in Switzerland. And by the way, I met both of them later on. And Nathan Schwalb came back to Palestine after the war. He was awarded all kind of recognition for his saving and doing. In Nonantola, the Della Sem rented a villa which belonged to a very rich Jew by the name of Villa Emma. This building still exists today. At that time it was empty. It was a building perhaps with 20 rooms, with a large kitchen, with running water, with electricity. The ideal thing for a home for children. They rented it for us, and it was sparsely furnished.
Where was the owner, the Jewish owner? Do you know that?
His name, I don't know.
Where was he?
He was a Modenese Jew.
I see.
And we really never met him. And we actually continued our life in Modena, in Villa Nonantola, the same way like we had in Lesnobrunner. Our school continued. We were very, very fortunate. We had never any sicknesses, because that would have been disastrous. And we had also developed a system where the clothes was handed down from one to the next, so if somebody grew out, somebody else had it. And Nonantola was more freedom for us. The Della Sem sent a director to Nonantola by the name of Yakir. A Dr. Yakir, and also an woman doctor. And they were actually in charge of having contact with the Italian authorities. And Joschko was in charge of the children, but they were in charge of the contact with the Italian authorities. We started to learn Italian. There were classes, and in the end I spoke quite fluently Italian, but in the beginning Joschka couldn't speak Italian, none of the people in the group, so the Jewish community sent Yakia, Dr. Yakia, which is an Italian Jew, to us as...
You remember how to spell that, Yakia?
J-A-C-C-I-A, I believe,
I see.
Yakia. And by the way, when we escaped to Switzerland, he didn't come with us. He stayed in Italy. And all the other people stayed in Italy. They didn't go with us. And our school existed, and a few months later, a second group of children, this time Yugoslavian children, reached us.
Had Yugoslavia been invaded at that time?
Yes, Yugoslavia was invaded from Germany, and the situation's gotten worse and worse. And finally, a group of children were sent from Yugoslavia, from the city of Split, to Nonantola to join us. And this group was 38 children. Mm-hmm. The interesting part is, I remember when they came, there was one child, barely 4 years old, and they picked up on the street of Sarajevo, crying, alone, and he couldn't remember his name. So Joshko and the other adults, not knowing what to do, they actually gave him a name, Aaron Khan. They didn't want to say Kohn, so they said Khan. Kohn is, you know, the Jews, Kohn the Levi. So. And he joined our group. So now the age changed. Now we were from 4 to 17, or from 4 to 18 perhaps, with the help of around 12, 13 adults. And woodworker, a Jewish woodworker, joined us, sent from the Ort. Ort found him in one of the internment camps in Italy, and he came to us, and he started a woodworking school in Nonantola. So that was the first Ort group during the war working in occupied in Italy. And we also started to work by farmers in order to learn the agricultural work. And we also sent children in the teenagers in the factory of Nonantola. There was a factory making juice, and I think it was shipped to Germany, not for our consumption.
And how long did this last in Villa Emma?
Villa Emma lasted quite a long time. It lasted till the British and American forces started to land in Anzio, and it changed in the moment when Mussolini was had to abdict, and Marshal Badoglio took over the government of the of Italy. The King Emmanuel was just a figurehead. And Badoglio tried to make peace or armistice with the British and American forces. But the Germans were against that, and they started to occupy Italy. They liberated Mussolini from Gran Sasso. They came down the Booth. They came down from Austria. They actually occupied Italy. A lot of Italian soldiers tried to escape, tried to go underground, and our camp, our Villa Emma, at that time was requested as a headquarters or as a building for the German occupying forces, and we had to leave. But before I come to that, I would like to tell you that Joschko established contact with the cloister and the church in Nonantola. And with one of the doctors, which came occasionally to our children when they had, colds or not really serious sicknesses, but he came, Dr. Bakari. And when we had to leave Nonantola, it was rather sudden. When we had to leave Villa Emma, it was rather sudden.
Did the Germans know that there were Jewish children in Villa Emma?
Yes. The German, as well as the fascists, knew. Because, I don't know if I told you before, the Italian government, the fascistic Italian government, partially supported our group financially.
Why would they do that?
Because it was an internment camp. The Villa Emma was a camp. It was a villa. But we were restricted in movement. We were under strict carabinieri, which is the police control. And they supported actually financially, partially. The rest was supported by the Italian Jewish community, by the Della Seine. So when we had suddenly to leave Villa Emma, before we had to do that, Joschko went to the priests and Dr. Bakari and asked them if the existing cloister in Nonantola is a big cloister for nuns and for novices, but only for girls, if they would take in the children. And after a little bartering, they said, yes, we take all children, girls, and my mother, a woman, and we take you if you take the priest habit, and you can stay with us, but we don't take the boys, the teenage boys. They took only the boys up to, I believe, 14, up till 14. But the bigger boys, they couldn't take because they had only a woman cloister. And they had a lot of girl novices. And so they couldn't. But the farmers in Nonantola and surrounding, they were told by the priest, take the boys. And we took shelter, and we got shelter with the farmers of Nonantola.
What was the name of the priest that was supervising this operation?
His name is in the Vajashem. In Palestine, and they planted trees in his name, and he got recognition as one of the righteous ones. And if you give me a few moments, I will remember, but right now I don't remember. But he and Dr. Bakari were brought to Israel after the war in, I think, 85, and they were bestowed the honor of the righteous people, and trees were planted in his name, and all the children which were in Palestine at that time came to this occasion, and there was a big celebration.
Very good.
So he was recognized for that.
Good. We'll just pause here until we change tapes.
Okay, the name I should know. Oh, God.
Robert Weiss, WEISS. This is roll six.
Robert, we were talking about escaping into the cloister, and you had the help of a Monsignor whom you...
Pilati, yeah.
Can you spell that?
P-I-L-A-T-I. And I would like to tell you a little bit more about the contact between the church and our group. And I'm going now back earlier times. Not always did we have the best contact with the church. And the relationship between our group and local priests were on a very individual basis, which means sometimes a local priest was very friendly to us and wanted to help him, but his community, or his, how should I say, community, didn't make it possible. But in Nonantola, there was a different wind. The church, under Monsignor Pilati's perhaps leadership, could get the population to help us. And perhaps also because the population there was under the finger of the local fascists, and they didn't like the local fascists. They were more likely to help us. For example, the farmers, they took us in open arms. And I don't want to say they were very well-educated people. That was the poorest of farmers you can imagine. They didn't have anything at all. But yet they shared whatever they had, what little they had, with us. Perhaps the local church pushed them a little bit, you know. They made them aware of our distress. Perhaps the other people didn't, but they did. And this is the reason why I want to give them so much credit. Under the most difficult circumstances, under the most harsh condition, under the fascistic rule and under the occupation now from Germans, they did help us. And there was another person I want to mention. His name is Pacifici. Chichibu is his name. It's very hard for me to spell. He lost his life helping us.
How is that?
Chichibu was an Italian Jew which came with Dr. Yakir and the dottoressa to our group, to Villa Emma, as a connector to the Italian government. He spoke fluently Italian, of course, he was an Italian Jew, but he could also speak German. So whenever we needed anything and we couldn't get it to the fascists and, or to the carabinieri or to the priests or to the doctor, he was the person in the middle. He was the contact between the Della Same and us. And now comes also the time where we have to escape, because the small children were in a cloister, and the nuns and also the priests told us, we would do everything for you, but this is temporary. This is a shelter of temporary nature.
You don't remember the name of the nunnery, the cloisters, do you?
No, the name I don't.
Okay.
But I know in Nonantola there is only one big basilica which exists today. And left to the basilica is a large cloister which still exists today the same way it was when I left. Mm-hmm. Most probably the nuns are not there anymore. Mm-hmm. But the nuns exist, and the school of the novices exists today because I visited them. But the names, I don't. I cannot tell you.
At what point did you know that you had to get out and make arrangements to leave?
That was the point when they told us, look, temporarily, we can take us. Temporarily, the older boys can stay with the farmers. But now that the Germans are here, sooner or later somebody will talk. Somebody will denounce you. And we cannot take the chance. You have to leave. And again, the Jewish pipeline works. And we found out that the only ventil open, the only way open out was to go to Switzerland.
This Pesivici, Chichibu,
yeah.
What connection did he have with you at that time?
Chichibu was sent to us from the Della Seme at the same time we took over the 30 or 38 children from the Yugoslav group from Split as additional help to communicate with their Italian authorities. At that time when we came to Nonantola, none of us spoke Italian. None of them in Italy, in Nonantola, spoke German. The communication was very, very difficult. There were a few Jews in Modena which spoke Yiddish, you know, so we could communicate. So immediately the Della Seme sent Dr. Yakia, which spoke Italian and German, as an middleman, right? Dr. Ressa came to us for medical, you know, supervision, and Pacifici, Chichibu, came also to help us. They didn't stay with us. Mm-hmm. So when the time, when we had to flee, when we had to go to the farmers, when the children went into the cloister, it was made to us to understand the nature that is very temporary. At the same time, we found out that the only way out is Switzerland. I forgot to mention something to you. Between Nonantola and Modena and British prisoner of war camp existed. And whenever we were in the fields, we sometimes were in contact with British officers and sergeants and military personnel, which were under the supervision of Italian third grade troops, you know, old soldiers, not really, and they were very lax. So we threw them a little message, and they threw a little message back, and even chocolate we got the first time in years. The small children got chocolate from the British and American soldiers, which were imprisoned. When Mussolini was imprisoned, and Badoglio tried to make armistice, at that time, they opened the gates of this prison camp. And all the Americans and British soldiers which were in the military prisoner of war camp escaped in the countryside. And they tried to make the way either south to the frontier where the fighting was and cross over to their troop, to their side. Or they tried to do the same thing what we did, go to Switzerland. Some of the older boys joined this group and went south. And a few managed to cross the German lines into the British lines and American lines and actually made it to Palestine in 1942, when the war was going on. A lot of those prisoners, I told you, where the camp was opened up, made it to, and went to their lines. But I have to mention one boy, because he should get recognition too. His name is Max Federmann. And Max Federmann was my age. And he was a native of Frankfurt, Germany. And Max Federmann went down south to reach the British-American forces, but didn't make it. He made it to the partisans in the Apennine. And he was one of the most recognized partisan fighter in the Italian war. And he got, after the war, medals from the Italian government. And the American government recognized him and gave him a preferred quota to emigrate in 1945 to the United States. So I want to recognize Max Federmann. He lives in California today too. But again, to come back to our situation, we knew we had to escape to Switzerland. Joschko sent Pacifici, Cicibu, to Milano, and from there to Como Chiasso, to the Swiss border, to find out the possibility of an escape route to Switzerland. At that time, you must understand, we are talking now October 43, the Americans and British forces bombed the Reggio Emilia area where we live continuously. If it was bombing by day, we knew it is the Americans. If it was bombing by night, we knew it is the British, because they had a train schedule going. And not only our area was bombed, I don't want that you think only we were bombed. They were bombing on the way to Germany, it overflew us. Trains between Modena and Milano were running, but not on a scheduled basis. All the passenger cars were taken from Italy and shipped to Germany because they needed them there. The railways were bombed out. So what they did in Italy, they had either open cars or just, the most crude cars available, and they used them for the civilian population. And when Cicibu traveled, and later on when we traveled on open cars or in just cars which were for animals or something like that. And we didn't know where the train really goes, and we didn't know when it will go, but we knew the direction it goes, and this railway goes to the next place is Reggio Emilia, and the next place is this and this. And finally, the end of the line is Milano. And we didn't know if it will take one day or 2 days.
And how many were you now? How many children and how many adults?
Now we were, good that you mention adults, because Yakia, and all the Italians left us. They went home. They didn't go into the cloister. The only person which stayed with us was Cicibu. He was the only one. And of course my mother, and but we were the refugees. So we tried to find a way to go to Switzerland. And contacts at that time were very, very limited. Whatever contact we had with Switzerland was broken off, because now we were in hiding. We had no way of getting messages. We decided the following. We have to split up. Arnold Weininger, Edgar Usher, his sister, and me. and Chichibu. We came together with Joshko. Joshko came out of the cloister, came to the farmers, and we had a little, what is called Sicha. We talked about it, and we decided we will try to find a way to Switzerland. We will try to find a possibility of sending money to buy the smugglers, and we will give you the direction how to do it. And on one day we left, and we went to Milan. Like I told you, on the way we were bombed in Reggio Emilia. The train was stopped on one side of the city. We had to walk to the other side of the city because the railway was just, was bombed out, the train couldn't continue. And on the other side of the city, they had another train waiting, and we continued. And we finally made it to Milano. Como Chiasso. In Como Chiasso, Chichibu found out that by Varese, Ponte Tresa, there is a possibility to cross the River Tresa. And the River Tresa is quite a large river, perhaps 20, 30 feet wide. But at one point, there is an underwater dam. An underwater dam is a stone construction where the top is perhaps 3 feet wide, but a foot underwater. On one side is a deep lake, or a deep, the water is dammed up, so that is a pretty deep area. And on the other side, water falls over the dam, perhaps 15 feet, 20 feet down to the river. I don't know exactly the reason why the dam is there, but perhaps it's a water control dam or something like that. But that is the only way somebody could cross the river, because one side of the river is Ponte Tresa, the Italian city, and on the other side is Switzerland. When we found this out, we decided that Chichibu will go back and notify Joshko. And Arnold Weininger, Edgar Usher, his sister, and me, we crossed, and we went to Switzerland. Now, not going the same way.
You didn't tell me how you crossed
no.
yet.
No, I just wanted to say, we couldn't get this way. So we went over Como Chiasso through the woods, and we chose a different way, because this way we wanted to preserve for the children. And we made our way from Como Chiasso to Lugano. Before we left, we got a few Swiss francs, which we obtained in Nonantola, an illegal way of getting money. And we traveled from Lugano to Zurich, where we had a contact with the Jewish community for many, many years, by the name of Dr. Lichtheim. And when we came to Zurich, main train station, three boys and one girl. We didn't know where it is. And there was Swiss police around and Swiss soldiers. And we approached an old woman. And we asked her for the address. And she looked at us and she said, I will never forget that, in very heavy Swiss German dialect, Heibel Ausländer, that means your dirty Ausländer, your dirty people from somewhere else or something like that. But she showed us the way how to go to Dr. Lichtheim's address. So as bad as she seemed to be, she was helpful to us. And Dr. Lichtheim kept us for a few days, made contact with the smugglers Chichibu found in Varese, and sent money. Because at that time they wanted 1,000 lira per person to smuggle to the way where the dam is. 1,000 lira wasn't so much because the Italian money wasn't the very best, but multiplied by 100, that was a large sum of money even for the...
Do you have any idea how he made contact with Varese?
With Varese?
Yeah.
In Switzerland, you could travel free.
No, I don't mean that.
Hmm?
I mean the contact. You said he contacted Chichibu, and they got money to
Switzerland. To tell you,
how did they make that contact?
The Switzerland was completely surrounded by Germany.
Yes.
And Switzerland at that time was very German friendly, because they knew if they wouldn't be, they would be overrun by the next day. So Germany used Switzerland as a depository for money, depository for spies, for precious metal, and for all kind of things. And the Italians had smugglers going back and forth between Italy and Switzerland, and they smuggled either food or cigarettes. And Switzerland let this be because they needed certain things too. They were completely surrounded by Germany. The Swiss Jews had free travel. They were Swiss nationals. They were very, very wealthy, very, very rich. They had all kind of money coming from the United States and from South America to help Jews. So money was never an object there. The object was how to get them in and how to keep them. The Jewish community in Switzerland was very small and never put any pressure on the Swiss government. And at the same time, Switzerland had a very German-friendly attitude and actually returned Jewish refugees on the border, taken on the border, directly into German hands. And I want to emphasize, in Yugoslavia, when the under Yugoslavian rule, still under Yugoslavian rule, if the Yugoslavian soldier captured the Jew on the border, he let them go back to Germany, but not in German hands. You know? His conscience was clear. I had to turn you back, but not in German hands. The Swiss never did that. The Swiss took them and gave them to the Nazis, gave them to the Gestapo.
How do you know that?
How? Well, again, perhaps only hearsay. But a wonderful film was made in Switzerland for their own people. The film name is The Boat is Full, and it's in all archives, and it tells the story of people returned into the hand of the Germans. To come back, we stayed 3-4 days. The money went to Ponte Tresa, to the smugglers, into the hand of Chichibu. And this we know because Joshko received the notification. Chichibu came back to Nonantola and told him, now you can bring the children.
About how old was Joshko at this time?
At that time, Joshko was perhaps 26, 27. Now, our time, we couldn't stay longer in the home of Dr. Lichtheim. We had to go to the Swiss Fremdenpolizei and represent us, which we did. And first they couldn't believe that we made it to Zurich, because we told them we came from Italy. And they said, how come you were not caught in Lugano, in the Italian part? So after a while, they interned us in one of their worst intern camps in the German part of Switzerland by the name of Büsserach.
Where was that near?
That was near Solothurn in Basel. Mm-hmm. And
this was the Swiss government.
The Swiss police concerned with foreigners. Fremdenpolizei. That's a special group of Swiss police. Under the Swiss government, of course. Now I have to come back to Chichibu. Chichibu received the money after a few days' wait. And he decided to make it back to Joschko, to bring the children. And can you imagine? He made the way back to Como Chiasso, to Milano, on those terrible train rides back, and he arrived in the beginning of October 1943 back in the cloister of Nonantola. At that time, nobody from the more adult teenage children, which were hiding by the farmers, existed anymore, because they took off and went south to the American and British lines. When Joschko got the notification from Chichibu that the way is open, he made an emotional goodbye to the nuns and to the priest and Dr. Bakari, and he decided to take the children, including my mother and Mr. Avin, our cook for many years, and made the way from Nonantola to Modena and from Modena to Milano and from there to Como Chiasso and Varese by train.
And you knew about this through your mother, was it? How did you know all these?
Well, first of all, my mother survived, and she came with me to later on to Palestine, to Israel, and finally to the United States.
But she told you about this.
Oh, yes, she told me the story. And, of course, I told I got the story told many times from Joschko.
Directly.
Directly and from the children. And I met the children later on.
Now,
Switzerland.
At this time, you were interned in Büsserach with this?
At this time, I was interned in Büsserach with Edgar Ascher and Arnold Weininger and Morino, another fellow. Four boys were interned in Büsserach. Under the most brutal and hard condition you would never have expected to be in Switzerland.
All right, let's hold that for the next tape. Ready?
Robert Weiss on the EISS. This is role
seven. Mm-hmm. Robert, you started to tell us about the terrible situation that you the four of you faced in Büsserach. Can you elaborate on that?
Yes. I was we were in a terrible mental stage too. Mm-hmm. Because, first of all, we felt we saved ourselves. And we left, I left my mother, I left all my friends, I left small children, still in Italy. I had to believe that when Dr. Lichtheim told me the money went to the frontier and went into Ichibu's hands, I had to believe that Ichibu would be able to go back. But all those things, sitting in Büsserach, I didn't know. I learned from that later on when my mother came and Joschka and the children came. But in those days of uncertainty, I was under a terrible mental pressure. Not only me, our little group. Now, the Swiss in Büsserach, that was a military-run camp, extremely strict. The food supply was completely limited to a quarter pound triangular cheese and potatoes boiled in water.
Who else was in this camp beside you?
I tell you. At the time I crossed the border, the Italian military disintegrated. They didn't want to fight the war anymore. And hundreds of soldiers, from officer rank down to the lowest soldier, tried to escape Italy and the possibility that they had to fight on the German command, still in the war. So they escaped to Switzerland. And the tragic part of the whole is that the Swiss accepted them more readily than the Jewish refugees just because they had a uniform on. In our camp in Büsserach, most people were actually ex-Italian soldiers coming at the same time I came over the border, perhaps in different locations, into Switzerland. To come back to Büsserach. Büsserach, the camp, was an old factory. They made the bricks there before they converted it to a camp. The walls were just brick walls. Water was coming down the brick wall. In the beginning, we had straw on the floor to sleep on. That was never changed. And they had an idea that in the morning we were driven out of the factory into the open, and we had to stay in the courtyard on our feet for hours. And that was a very cold winter too, October 43. We were underfed, underclothed, and only occasionally at the time of meals we were allowed back into the house, into the building. So Büsserach was a bad time.
Where was the woman that was with you? What happened to her?
The Swiss segregated man and woman. The woman, Alice Ascher is her name, was interned in a woman camp. Offhand, I don't know the name. To come back now to my mother, I shouldn't say my mother first, to the children's group, including my mother. Miraculous. Chichibu, Pacifici, made his way back to Nonantola. At that time, all the more adult children hiding out by the farmers couldn't stay there anymore. They made their way south to the frontier lines between Italy or German troops now and American and British forces fighting, or the jointed partisans, like Max Federmann did. Chichibu contacted Joshko and they decided to take the whole group that was now close to 100 children and 8 adults. And I want to tell you that all the Italian adults left. They went back home. So only Mr. Avin, the cook, my mother, Joshko, you know, a few left, and only Chichibu stayed with us. They had a very emotional goodbye with the nuns. And they made their way miraculously, the same way with open freight cars under the most horrifying situations to Modena, and from Modena to Milano, from Milano to Como Chiasso, to Varese. I think it took them 2 days. And in Varese, Joshko asked Chichibu to come with us, to come with him to Switzerland. And Chichibu refused. And Chichibu said, there are more Jews left in the northern part of Italy which need me to guide them to this spot. And he said goodbye, and he went back to help other refugees interned in small communities in the northern part of Italy. Unfortunately, we found out later on, the Germans caught him and put him on the wall and just shot him. So Chichibu Pacifici, our savior of the group, died a few days later. To come back to our group, it was night. The day of Kol Nidre, one of the most holy days in Jewish life. And the few adults, when they came to the water, it was at night time, and the smugglers told them, the Germans are not here right now. The German frontier, now is the time to cross. They could only see under very difficult circumstances, the 2 feet of wall under the water. I must tell you that I came back to the same spot 3 years ago and showed it to my wife. I wanted to see her where the children crossed. So the adults, Mr. Avin, my mother, and which were left, they joined hands, walked across, and pulled by joined hands the whole group over. And not one of the children was lost. By the way, I forgot to mention something. Joshko took along 4 British officers which were hiding in the area when they escaped out of the British camp. And we thought having British with us, it would help us perhaps in negotiation with the Swiss. They disappeared. And Joshko took also an Tunisian family, a Jewish family with very old people along. And they made him a terrible hard time because they shouted and in situations where the children were quiet and were deadly afraid that the Germans or the Swiss will catch them. They were not even cooperating with that. But Joshko took them along. And when they crossed the border, when they crossed the river and they were on the other side, they found Swiss soldiers. And in the first moment, Joshko thought that they're Germans because the uniform is green and in the night you cannot really differentiate, but they were actually Swiss soldiers. And they took them as wet and as dripping with water, and they brought them to a building. But they didn't allow them and didn't give them the assurance of entry. By crossing the river, all belongings the children carried were lost. They were taken away with the water. The beautiful part is that on the other side, Swiss people were able to save the belongings. It washed up on the river. And most of the things came back to the group and to Joshko. And a few of the documents I showed you survived that way. My mother got almost all her things back. But on the way of crossing, everything was lost. A day or two later, I forgot to tell you, the Swiss police or the Swiss military forces on the site of Ponte Tresa informed their authorities, and they knew, because of Dr. Lechtheim, that this group is coming or will eventually come, and now we are here. So it took 2 days of intense negotiation between the Jewish community between the Swiss Jewish community and the Swiss government, till the Swiss government accepted the responsibility to take the Jews which crossed this river under those circumstances into their hands. And all the children and the few adults which came with them were interned. And my mother was interned in Montreux. And it took a while till the Jewish community could organize a building and facilities for suddenly 400 children. They were unexpected. And there was nothing like that ever happened in Switzerland. So they were able to get a large building in Bellebin, which is in the vicinity of Montreux, in the canton of Wallis in Switzerland. And all the children, and Joshko and my mother and Mr. Avin, were united there, and they really started the same Hakshara, the same learning facilities they tried to have years before, up to this point, also in Switzerland.
How did you make contact with them?
I was in Büsserach, and Dr. Lechtheim sent me sometimes a few francs, 6 francs, 5 francs, into the camp, and also notes. And on one, I got a letter from my mother. So you can imagine what that meant to me.
She had sent it to him?
Right. He knew
about her.
About her. He knew about me, of course. And when he made contact, he sent me the note. And of course, he also let Joshko know where we are. We were four people, and Alice. And Joshko asked him if it would be possible to unite, to get us out from there and bring us into the same group again. And I think it took 3 months till we were allowed to leave Büsserach and join them in Bellebin.
How long did you remain in Bellebin?
In Bellebin, we stayed till August of 1945, when we got certificates
from
Palestine, from the British government. British Mandate government of Palestine for legal entry into Palestine. It took that long, the war was already over, because they had to find a way to bring us from Switzerland to France, to Spain, and then charter a ship, a small ship, which brought us to Haifa.
And you did that mostly by bus, train, car?
No, the travel in 1945 was through Switzerland and France and up to Port Bou, and then to Barcelona was by train. And that was through Europe to France just after the war, a few months after the liberation, actually. And a lot of things were, still in terrible shape. But we were free. We were under different circumstances.
But how did you get legal certificates to enter a British-mandated
area? That is a very interesting story. In Switzerland, at that time, of course, there was no Austrian government that you could require. I was an Austrian citizen. That you could get Austrian passports. The German children couldn't get German passports. And I forgot to mention, we took also in 100 Hungarian children, which came from the Kastner transport. That is an interesting story, because an American negotiation started with the Nazi government, the Nazi military, to liberate Jews out of the concentration camps in exchange for trucks. And the German government allowed 300 Jews to be liberated from German concentration camps into Switzerland in expectations that the American government will give them 100 trucks, which never materialized. The negotiations, of course, broke off the moment the children and the Jews crossed the Swiss border.
These were Jewish children from Hungary?
99% from Hungary. And this transport was called the Kastner transport.
How do you spell that?
K-A-S-T-E-T-N-E-R.
Why was it called
Kastner? Because the negotiation was done by a gentleman by the name of Kastner.
A Jewish?
I cannot tell you that. Mm-hmm. I don't know. I cannot really verify. But he did this apparently the German believed him. The German released. The children came to our group in Nonantola, in Beleben.
300.
No, 300 Jews were released from German concentration camps that were adults too. But around 100 children came to us in Beleben.
So how many were you now traveling through France and Spain to the ship to
Before Palestine? We could travel, we were close to 300. We had to get papers. There was no way that we could get German, Hungarian, Austrian passports. So the Swiss government decided to give everyone from our group, after the British government in Palestine, the mandate, gave us the certificates to immigrate, they gave us a passport, which is a Nansen pass, very unusual name. Fridtjof Nansen was the first United Nations president. He was a Norwegian Arctic explorer. And he made a ruling that they displaced the refugees which lost their homeland, their nationality, should get an international accepted passport. That was called the Nansen-Pass.
Can you spell that, Nansen-Pass?
N-A-N-S-E-N, and passport is passport. What it is a piece of paper. When you open it up, every government issuing it, in our case, it was the Swiss government, issues a statement that this and this person is an Austrian citizen or Norwegian citizen, Polish citizen, Dutch citizen, born so and so, and all the things. And it is only good, valid for one-way travel, which means you could exit, but you could never enter. And on one part of the paper are all your documented entries. On the other side of the paper is the British mandate certificate stamp and the exit visas and also the entry visas. So when we received, each one of us, the Nansen Pass, we also received the legal way of leaving Switzerland. And the Swiss Jewish community paid the way from Bailburn to Barcelona. In Barcelona, we were taken over from the joint, the Jewish organization there. They rented a small ship by the name of Plus Ultra, and Portuguese tramp ship, you know, one of the small boats, and that brought us to Haifa.
And how many of you disembarked in Haifa?
In Haifa, you must understand, our group was at that time 300. But we collected now Jews from all over France, from all the camps in concentrated. They were brought to a point in Barcelona, a collecting point. And when this ship going to Palestine, to Haifa, was full to the capacity, I would say it was perhaps 700 people, including our group of 300. It sailed.
What time of year was that?
That was August 95. 45. 1945. And in Palestine, we were the first legal immigrants, because before that day, only illegal immigrants arrived, which means people coming by night, you know, mm-hmm. under the most difficult circumstances. We came legally. And we were immediately interned from the British in the camp of Atlit. Okay. And we had to stay there 3 weeks in quarantine. But that was an medical quarantine, that was nothing,
Before we go on to talk about Palestine and the war for independence, did I ask you what happened to Aaron Mentzer?
Unfortunately, the end of Aaron Mentzer was not a good one. Aaron Mentzer saved, I don't want to say me, he saved us all. His doing and his finding a way out with Schleich, also if he paid a lot of money, it was saving souls. And Aaron Mentzer very easily could have left Vienna, either with me or with later people, and he could have saved himself. Aro Mentzer never was a person like that. Because as long as he had one child under his supervision, he wouldn't leave that child. It came to a day when the Germans, when the Gestapo eliminated the UAL. And with the last transport going to Poland and now to, at that time, Theresienstadt, and from Theresienstadt they were sent to the extermination camps. He selected to go with the group. And he went with the children. And Aaron Mentzer died in Auschwitz. Today there is a monument in the only surviving Jewish temple in Vienna about Aaron Mentzer. And of course a book was written.
Do you have any idea about the children? Are we to assume that the children also died in Auschwitz?
The children died with him. Later on, they found, written by children, all the names and birth dates, and even addresses of the last group.
Well, we're going to change tapes again, and we will hear your story of Palestine.
EISS, this is roll number 8.
Robert, we have arrived in Palestine, Eretz, Israel, and you and the children and the other adults are now interned in Atlit for health separation, whatever they call it, and then continue the story, would you please?
Okay. When we arrived in Atlit, the small Jewish yeshuv in Palestine.
Explain yeshuv, please.
Yeshuv is the Jewish people in Israel, which at that time were very Zionistic. They were enthusiasts, and they were in an euphoric mood, because there were already 100 children there which knew about us. They were expecting us for 4 years. Mm. Even some of our children were the brothers and sisters of the children which came before them. In the meantime, those 100 which came before us, some of them had joined the Jewish British Brigade. They had fought in Italy on the other side where we were, in order to liberate Europe. One by the name of Vado died in the fighting around Ravenna and is still buried there. Of course, they knew we are in Atlit. They came to the camp to welcome us, right? And it was a tremendous feeling. In the time where we were not lit, we had also to make decisions where to go. Some of the children had relatives in Palestine, and they decided to go to them, or they were taken in by them. But most of the children, including me, we decided to go to the kibbutzim. That was the way we were trained for the 3-4 years wandering through Europe in the Hakshara system. And we thought that would be the time to give back something to the Jewish people. And by working in the kibbutzim, we could do that. And I decided to go in a kibbutzim of Hashomer Hatzair, because that was the affiliation I selected even in Vienna when I was with Aaron Menzer. And some other people, Manny Isler, which was in Mizrahi, which was more religious and because of that was affiliated with Mizrahi. He went to kibbutzim, which was governed by Mizrahi, a more religious surrounding. Some of the children went to different places.
And you?
I went to, first of all, I didn't know which kibbutz I should go. And one day, a selection of Hashomer Hatzair kibbutzim came, and it was decided by them that the kibbutz Amir in Galil, a rather young group of people, would be able to take 10 of the group, because they couldn't take all of them. They were only able to take 10. Another kibbutz took another 10, and so we all split up. Yoshko went to his kibbutz Gat in the Negev. By splitting up, I would like to emphasize, we really never split up, because we stood, or we are still standing in contact with each other. Even if it is only through the mail now, and even if we all have glasses and perhaps somebody is not in the very best health and we are in the 70s today, when we look out from with our eyes, when we see one of our people, we see only the child we were, the teenagers, whatever we did together. We never really aged. We were really good Zionists. And when I joined the Kibbutz Amir, I also joined the Palmach. The Palmach was the Jewish underground, security force. There was no military force, there was no real police force or something like that. It was called Palmach. And in each of the outlying kibbutzim, and the Amir was very outlying, it was in the upper Galil, there was a small group, small cadre of Palmachniks, people of the Palmach. And we went to a very rigorous training. It was an overt training because the British forces didn't allow Jews to have legally any weapons. Every weapon had to be obtained illegally, sometimes under very difficult and costly circumstances. And when we trained, we had to train by night and out of the sight of Arab eyes. And, it was not an open training. But we were very well trained. And sometimes we were called to action. And one action I have in mind to bring to your remembrance. One night, 7 bridges were destroyed in Palestine as a protest against the British taking Jewish people to the prison camp in Atlit. And when the Jordan Bridge was exploded in the vicinity of Jerusalem, I was there. And I'm pretty proud about it. At that time, we were called terrorists. It changes. We were very active when the illegal immigration of refugees from Europe started, because the British never allowed the surviving Jews from the survivors of the concentration camps from Germany and Austria coming to Italy and looking for a way to come to Palestine, to come to Palestine. As a matter of fact, every one ship they caught, they sent either to Cyprus or to Mauritius, to islands, but they never let them land. But many boats were able to bring survivors in. They were taken in by the Palmach, dispersed in the kibbutzim, and they just disappeared in the country. I'm very proud of having helped that way too. And when after, I think, a few months in Amir, by the way, I started to learn Hebrew, I'm Ivrit. After a few months, perhaps a half a year, it was decided to go on our own. We were a group of perhaps 30 teenagers. We wanted to have our own kibbutz. And we started under the name of Nachshonim in Ramat HaSharon, not far from Herzliya. We were given a small parcel of land on we were given it free, but we had to pay back the money to the Karim Kayemet. And we started an agricultural settlement there. Later on, we built even a little factory extracting olive oil with presses. And the time came, and it became apparent that sooner or later the climate in Palestine will change. The British wanted to leave the mandate. The United Nations debated if it should come to an partition, you know. And the Arab Maraot, the Arab attacks on Jewish communities and on Jewish buses and on Jewish facilities started. And of course the Jews reacted. And who reacted was the Palmach or the Jews itself. At that time, the Jewish community decided that the Negev was needed, whatever happened. And 16 places in the Negev were built almost overnight as strategic points. It was not really agricultural because we couldn't do anything at that time. And in most of those points, there was no water. Water had to be trucked in. And Amir and Ramat HaSharon, Nachshonim, our kibbutz, decided to occupy one point. The point was named Chazali. C-H-A-S-L-I, Chazali. Alumim. And 28 boys and girls, including me, went to the Negev.
Your mother was where at this time?
In Ramat Gan. She was already, she didn't join the kibbutz. So when we went to the Negev. We had one one concrete building, Beit Bitachon, that has that is called House and Security Building. Three barracks out of wood and a small water tower with perhaps 2 cubic meters of water. No water. But the point was 16 kilometers south of Beersheba. And by having this particular point, the Arabs never really could claim Beersheba, because Beersheba suddenly was surrounded by Jewish points. On one side was Bet Eshel, Nevatim, Rivivim, Chalutza, Chazali. We surrounded actually Beersheba. We had no street going to us. The street ended in Beersheba, 15 miles was through the sand, 15 kilometers was through the sand. And unfortunately, at the same time, the Arab fighting started. And the corridor between the northern part of Palestine and the southern part of Palestine is very, very narrow. There is only a strip of land, perhaps 4 kilometers wide, in Jewish hands, between the northern and the southern part. And our, and of course the road goes through. And one kibbutz, Nekba, is close by, actually guarding this narrow point. But we knew if this point is broken, if this strip is broken, the whole southern part of Palestine, the whole Negev, will be isolated. Strategically, if you look at the old maps, it was a nightmare. Nobody could, nobody with the right mind would believe a country can be held where a strip of land by Jerusalem is only 25 kilometers wide. 40 million Arabs were against 800,000.
He's there. He's there. Okay. Keep going.
8,000 Jews. The keys on the side of the door was against the Jews. 800,000 Jews. 800,000 Jews. But it came to that. And we had to fight. And we sustained. And I believe, looking back now, that is really what the Arabs resent most. The Arabs resent that they couldn't push the Jews into the water, because that's what they say they will do. And, of course, they couldn't do.
Was anybody lost from your group? Were you attacked?
Yes, we lost quite a few. In the Negev itself, we lost 5 people. And 4 or 5 were wounded. But the main objective to all the war of independence was achieved. The Negev was kept in Jewish hands.
Thank God. Thank you. How long did you remain in the Negev?
In the Negev, completely encircled, because now the bridge between the northern part of Israel was broken. The Arabs occupied the area. We were completely surrounded for 8 months. The only supply we got in was either by foot illegally to their lines or by airplanes. And the Jews were able, the Jews were able to get mostly South American Dakota airplanes, sometimes flown by South American pilots, or South African pilots, I should say, flag material into the surrounded Negev. And that's the way the Negev actually held out. Without the help of the outside, we could never have done it. Another thing you have to consider, none of the points, or most of the points, had no water. Mm-hmm. Water was more important to us than food. You can sustain without food, but in that heat, under Khamsin conditions, you needed water. And of course, we rationed water. We had to truck in water. And the trucking was always a danger point because the Arabs tried to disrupt the ways we brought in the water.
How many months did you remain in the Negev afterwards? You said you were there for 8 months. What transpired?
For 8 months, we were completely surrounded.
I see.
In 1949, Israeli Defense Forces, at that time it was already an organized army. When I was in the Palmach, we had no uniforms, we had no officers. The Palmachnik selected to guide us was selected by us, it was not an officer. But Ben Gurion decided to make an Israeli Defense Force. And he built up an army. And suddenly we had uniforms, and suddenly we got also weapons, and suddenly we got an officer corps, and suddenly the whole thing changed. The Palmach was taking over. Our group was called the Hanegev Battalion. And the way to the north was opened. The Negev actually was liberated. We went into the Elat area, which is today Elat. That was a little Arab Transjordanian point. Umrasras is the name. And I was one of the first ones there. We did unbelievable things. Engedi, on the shores of the Dead Sea, was completely surrounded for 10 months. And we got radio messages, itut messages. We didn't have really radios at that time either. We had heliographs where the sunlight was transmitted in Morse code on visual distances. And I went in with a couple of jeeps and two trucks at one day, and we brought food from our little supplies we selected, and we brought food to Engedi. And of course we couldn't stay there either, so we had to break through again and out. But Engedi survived.
After the war, did you go back to Amir?
I was many times in Amir, yes. I was many times in Amir, and I was... By the way, Amir doesn't exist today anymore. They abandoned Amir. The kibbutz turned into a moshav, and the kibbutzniks, which were highly idealistically, when I was there and shared everything, suddenly wanted to have more individual ownership of the land. So they started to split up, and now it is not a collective anymore.
Where did you live? Where did you spend the days after the war? Where did you settle?
Okay. After the war, I went to Gedera and started to work for the fledgling small Israel Air Force. And I was very close with the president of Israel today, Chaim Weizmann.
Ezra Weizmann,
which was in the Air Force at my time, and he flew Piper paper cups. And I went into the Air Force as a civilian. I worked in Tel Nof in the engine overhauls. But by 1951, I left Israel and I came to the United States. And because of my experience with the Air Force, I went here to the Academy of Aeronautics. I graduated in 1957, and then I worked for 24 years for American Airlines. But the beginning of my career, actually, the airline industry is in Israel.
Can you tell us briefly why you left Israel?
Well, out of a few reasons which compelled me to leave, I came and I was a real idealist. I was a real Zionist. I was a youngster of perhaps 18, which went into a kibbutz, which had the idea of building up the land, returning the land, which was not very productive, and we got it back to the original states of thousands of years where there were cedar trees and so on. And I tried my very best. I joined the Palmach. I fought in the War of Independence. I never took any money. I never had any money because everything was joined collectively. And when the war ended in 1949, I decided to leave and go on my own. And to bring you only an example, when I was with the first troops into Beersheba, and we liberated, or not liberated, but we fought for Beersheba. And Beersheba was suddenly in Jewish hands. And there was no Arab left there. We found a Taggart fortress. We found beautiful buildings. We found also shabby Arab shacks. But everything was left like it was, like the Arabs, just flat. And everything was here for the taking. We didn't take anything because we thought that doesn't belong to us. And we had still more fighting to do. When I came the next time back to Beersheba, that was perhaps a month later, all those beautiful buildings were already occupied. And they were occupied by people from Romania, Poland, by latecomers. We felt not people which helped us fight, but people which came afterwards, and they took profit of it. But that was not the main point. I went to work in Tel Nof. I went to work for an engine overhaul. And in the meantime, I got also in contact with people which, for my family, survived. For example, Otto Perl, which was in Dachau, later on in Insel, an Isle of Man, came to the United States. I decided, and the economic situation in 50-51 in Israel was not a very good one. It was a very hard one, a harsh one. And thousands of new immigrants came to Palestine between 49 and 51, and that was only the first wave of immigrants. Those immigrants were not Zionists. They were not the caliber we had when I came. Those were people from Algeria, from Morocco, displaced persons from Europe. The saying was, Chosse Brera, we have no other choice. That is the reason they came. And that was the time when I said, okay, now I want to look for a better life and a different life, let's put it this way. And I decided to come to the United States. Something else pushed a little bit. When I was in Switzerland in 1945, before knowing that I ever will get a certificate to come to the to Palestine legally, I put in for the Austrian quota to come to the United States. At that time, the Austrian quota took 5 years waiting till your number came up. In 1951, my number came up, and I could get legal entry. I could get an affidavit. So I took the opportunity.
You were notified through the Austrian embassy in Tel Aviv. How did you get notice?
No, the notification came from the United States, actually.
Nice. Yeah. Okay, Robert, we're coming to the end of this tape, and we'll conclude on tape number 9. Thank you.